1 hour, and so we are going to start our course on triple trouble, hard cataracts, loose zonules, and subluxated lenses. So we'll run through some difficult situations and we'll see how it goes. So let's have a look at the first case. So this lady was lying in a hotel by the pool and a mango fell on her eye. She put Ciplox for 3 to 4 days because she went to the GP, and that's what people usually do when something happens. They don't first go to the eye doctor, they go to the general practitioner, and she was in Goa. And so the first thing everyone puts is Ciplox eye drops. It's one of the best known brands all over the country. Of course, the vision became worse. She came back to Bombay, and on presentation, her IOP was 50. She had a clear cornea, a mid-dilated pupil, and a lens luxating into the anterior chamber, shutting the angle. So in this kind of situation, you cannot enter the eye with intraocular pressure of 45, 50, 55, because what happens when you put a nail or you cut a tire which is under pressure, it explodes. So you don't want expulsive hemorrhage and stuff like that, vitreous pouring out of the eye. So you always reduce the IOP. So we gave her mannitol, we gave her oral Diamox, and about an hour or two later, when we find the IOP has come down to manageable levels, we take up the case. So let's see how this went. So you can see that the lens has partially luxated into the anterior chamber because the zonules have given way at 6 o'clock due to the blunt trauma. So consider this basically a blunt trauma case. You need to do a small and definitive capsular rexus. You cannot have the rexus run out because you don't know what's going to happen next. So once we take the rexus around, you do a good hydro dissection. You can see the fluid wave going across, and this gives you a good idea to assess, you know, how good is the zonular stability. So I'm using iris hooks in this case. 5 iris hooks come in a pack to hold the capsule. So we are holding the capsular bag, and now using lower parameters, you just do a very simple phaco. Most of it is irrigation aspiration because she didn't have a hard nucleus or a cataract in the first place. This is like a blunt trauma. Now the next challenging step is to do irrigation aspiration because you have to do this slowly. Remember, your bag is being held by the 5 hooks. So, you know, you have to gauge, hold the cortex, pull it a little, see if the bag is coming off the hooks. You have to be a little careful. So you go in between the hooks and you slowly peel the cortex to the periphery. Don't use 500 and 600 vacuum because your posterior capsule will be moving back and forth because it's not being supported. It's like a trampoline where the elastic bands have become loose. So once that is done, I always inject in a tension ring in a case like this. So if your tension ring is a large, this is a 12 millimeter tension ring from Oftec, and this will give you enough support without having to use a ring segment. So that is what I've been aiming for. So inject the ring in one motion smoothly, and then put the lens into the capsular bag. So I waited, I had a look, because if the lens was starting to come forwards, there was not enough support from the tension ring and the remainder of the zonules that are present, I'd put in an Ehmert segment and suture it. But luckily for us in this case, you can see everything's good, the AC is well formed, so we could end the case like this. Now coming to the next situation, in a gross subluxation, should we use a ring segment, and when is the situation where you cannot use a ring segment and you have to use another device? So let's have a look at this. So use capsule hooks in subluxation or drop anchor is a video I had presented at ESCRS. So this case has gross amount of subluxations, young child. So we use the femtosecond laser system catalyst in this case, and you get this beautiful capsular rexus. You saw Suhas doing it with a Zepto. This is Ike Ehmert's personal technique of using viscoelastic to push the cortex away from the fornix of the capsular bag. And you can see that we are easily able to put the iris. In this case, we're using capsule hooks, not iris hooks, because I'm going into the fornix of the capsular bag. So I don't want the sharp edge of iris hooks to tear. Now I railroad this suture out of the eye. Railroad it out of the eye. And you have connected this proline suture to the ring segment. So now the ring segment is in the eye and inside the capsular bag. I have also put a capsular tension ring. You can see the two ends there. And you can very easily implant a lens in the capsular bag. But now what if you have a poor rexus with a small rim of capsule? What options do we have in this case? Because you cannot suture in a ring, it will flip out. Here we dock the patient onto the femto system, but you can see the system hasn't done a proper rexus. So we are left doing a manual rexus on top of this. So sometimes technology does fail you, especially when the technician you have on that day is an idiot and doesn't set it properly. So it has done a capsular rexus under the capsule in the cortex. Okay. So this is a unique situation. Now I've done a rexus and the rexus has run out. So when the rexus is run out onto the capsular margin, we need a two-pronged device called an Assia anchor. So out come the proline sutures again. And you thread it through the dialing hole of the anchor here. That's the dialing hole. So you can suture it through that. And now you railroad the suture out of the eye. So this is the same proline suture that you use for a ring segment. There's nothing fantastic about this. Anyone can do this. The only thing is that you need this. It's like a paper clip basically. And it has two legs. So those two legs will snag the remaining capsule. Because you cannot fit a ring segment in there. The rexus has gone to the periphery. Once you do an INA and remove the cortex, you can see the capsule has been very nicely snagged by these two legs. Now, all that you have to do is pass the needle twice through half thickness of sclera. So you just need a conjunctival peritomy. You don't have to make a scleral flap and do all kinds of other technically difficult steps. The easiest thing is to pass the suture twice through half thickness of sclera, and that will lock it in place. So now you've got a good capsular bag held in place by anchor here. In goes the lens, injected on top of a repositor so it doesn't spring open suddenly and dislodge. If at this stage you are going to dislodge the anchor, you had it. You'll have to go all the way in, support the capsular bag and refixate it. So that's the end of the situation that we can easily manage. Let's go to the next set of videos. So if you see the course summary, it says, does femtosecond laser cataract surgery really work, or is it just an expensive toy that rich people buy to intimidate everyone else? So when I was transitioning to, I was lucky enough that the center had a femtosecond cataract machine, as I probably wouldn't have bought one. You have to learn the machine and its settings yourself so you can avoid bad situations like you saw in the last case where one technician goes on leave and the other guy comes and it does capsular rexus in the cortex instead of on the capsule. Practice on grade 1 to 2 cataracts first. Don't find a hard cataract to try this on. You need a widely dilated pupil to learn femtocataract surgery. You cannot, despite all the videos, wonderful videos you see from fantastic surgeons, remember that you will have a hell of a time if you do a small rexus and then you have to do all kinds of maneuvers in the capsular bag. And naturally, posterior polar cataracts, subluxated lenses and traumatic cataracts are not the cases to learn flax or any kind of cataract surgery on. Of course, you get a good rexus. You get some amount of lens fragmentation. So let's have a look at a very simple video first. So transitioning to flax, just like learning cataract surgery, is a procedure to be done on simple cases. You dock a patient on like this. The machine does an OCT. I think everyone has seen these things before, so we'll go a little ahead. You decide where the posterior capsule is. You floor it. After adjusting all your parameters, So that's your rexus and fragmentation complete. So this is a, like a grade 2.5 cataract, not even grade 3. That's your rexus. So you pinch it centrally, because sometimes the femto laser will not give you a complete rexus. And if you just go in and you peel it off, you will have a tag that extends instantly to the periphery. Remember that these are patients who have paid you nearly twice the amount of money they would obviously have paid otherwise, and are not going to be very happy with a less than perfect outcome. So that stress of having to do perfect surgery every time is increased when you counsel a patient and tell them, oh, you need femtosecond laser cataract surgery, because now they expect something fantastic. They expect that if Gauri auntie living on fourth floor was seeing after 3 days, they must see in the evening only. Otherwise, something's really wrong here. Okay? So that is why you don't try to learn these surgeries on difficult cases, because you'll just increase your stress level. The main thing that I'm trying to point out here is that after doing your emulsification, doing cortical cleanup is sometimes more difficult. You have to go in the fornix of the bag and peel out. Because if you don't go in the fornix and peel out, you cannot do an IA. Regular phacoemulsification, you just wave your probe there near the capsular margin and you will catch pieces of cortex, because there's a cortical frill left behind after phaco and you can peel it, but here you cannot. So you have to do a little bit of relearning how to do IA, and you have to go in the fornix of the capsular bag. Most people will not tell you this, but you realize this very soon after doing the first few cases, that your irrigation aspiration is going to be a little different, and that's why you don't want a small pupil, because then you can't see where you're going in the fornix of the bag. And the main advantage is that you get that perfect overlap like this, which you will never get with a manual rexus. Let's have a look at the next case now. So this is where the femtosecond laser was created. It was supposedly created so that you can do a grade 5 like this. Once again, it's done a rexus. Now the whole idea of having femto laser as an assisting influence on your surgery is that you get pre-fragmented blocks. But in a very dense cataract like this, you still have to embed the tip and you still have to use mechanical force. You can see I'm pulling on the chopper to separate the pieces. Yes, you do get a line of fragmentation, but it's a myth that you're going to go in the eye and 5 pieces are just going to come floating out and disappear in the tip. That's incorrect. You are still going to use phaco emulsification. You are still going to use phaco energy. You will use less phaco energy, but use it you will. See, now in this pupil is small, so we are going in the periphery, and while pulling out the cortex, we have managed to dislodge the bag here, as you will see. Because you have to go in the fornix of the bag. See, you can see this edge here, and that's your capsule which has unfurled, because you're going inside here and peeling cortex. So you don't know if you're peeling cortex or you're peeling capsule. And this is one of the challenging situations that we do encounter now and then with femtocataract surgery. Luckily, I have not caused a rent. It is just basically the capsule has unfurled, because by you have pulled on the capsule instead of the cortex and you have torn some zonules here. Now you can inject your lens in after finishing your cortical cleanup. So yes, femtosecond laser does have a learning curve, and it's improper to think that, you know, you just buy the machine and you sit and now you never have to learn rexus and you never have to learn how to do phaco, because the machine will do everything. This is the impression that patients have, but nothing can be further from the truth. So now I'm going to call the next speaker, Dr. Ritika Sachdev. He's not ready. Okay. We're going to call Professor Keki Mehta to speak to us on a few complicated situations. We have 2 more speakers after him. We have Dr. Ritika Sachdev and the evergreen and popular Gaurav Luthra, who is sitting in the fourth row. Gaurav, please come in the front.